Hello there and welcome to Proper DIY. So today I'm going to be leveling my lawn so I can finally get rid of my lumps and bumps. Well, glad we're coming out of spring and straight into summer. So you join me part way through this process. And so far, I've given the lawn a really short haircut and I've scarified it. And I've not shown you any of that because you can see that in far more detail in a previous video I made called How to Scarify Your Lawn Properly. I'll put a link up here and in the description below. So the reason I've scarified before I've started to level the lawn with sand is twofold. First of all, I want to get all the rubbish out the lawn and get down to the soil surface, because as well as leveling lawn, I'm reseeding as well. So I want as much rubbish out the lawn as possible to allow that seed to germinate and to get well established. And secondly, it's only when I scarify that I really cause major damage to the weeds in my lawn. See, most of the weeds I've got in my lawn tend to grow horizontally, like poa annua, and I've also got other creeping things that tend to fly out, and they never seem to get cut properly. It's only when I scarify that I rip those to shreds, which is a good thing. So I need to do a bit more cutting, but I'll show you what I've been using to scarify. So this is the scarifying cartridge that fits onto my Alec Kensington, and it's got lots and lots of these springy tines that whiz round and rip all the nasty stuff out of your lawn. Now, if the comments from my last video are anything to go by now lots of you are shouting at your screens to tell me that this isn't scarifying. Well, as far as I'm concerned, it is scarifying. This is the Alec scarifying cartridge. If you don't believe me, go and have a look at the Alec website. I'll put a link in the description below and they'll tell you all about scarifying and verticutting as well. Anyway, while you're doing that, I'm going to change this cartridge because I've got one small cut left to do where the poa annua is sitting up, and I've got to get that out of the way the best I can before I start leveling. So excuse me while I change cartridges. I find that the process of scarifying does raise quite a lot of grass and weeds that then stand upright like they didn't before. So giving it another cut after scarifying is quite often required. So the sand I'm going to be using today to level the lawn is what my local company calls their lawn repair mix. And it's 50% sand and 50% compost and organic matter. That's why it's so dark. And they sell this to golf clubs and parks and greenkeepers all over the place for exactly the same purpose. What's nice to see is that this has been sitting here for a couple of weeks and I've already got growth coming out of it here, which is a good sign, which means that there is organic matter in there, and hopefully, just like these weeds are taking off in the surface, so will my grass. So I'm going to be putting sand on this lawn in two phases. The first phase is to fill up all the deep lumps and bumps. I'm sitting in one at the moment. From where I'm sitting to here must be maybe 2 inches difference. So I'm going to fill areas like this, fill all the valleys, and I'm going to have to compact them. If I don't compact them now, they will do over time. So I'd rather compact them now, get them out the way. The second phase is then to go over the whole lawn with a thin layer of sand to fill up all the small lumps and bumps I can't necessarily see at the moment, but I know is there because when I take my lawnmower over it, I'm bumping all over the place. Now, in the deeper areas, like where I am and all the valleys, I could well be smothering the grass because I'm putting so much sand on top of it, it could well die. But anyway, that's just a part of life. This is where I'm going to have to overseed at the end of this job. And if the grass doesn't grow through again, well, that's just the way it is. I can't spend 5 years gradually coming up an inch at a time. I need to get this done now. So that's the way it is. So now comes the heavy work of moving the couple of ton of sand around the garden. I start by just placing piles of material in the biggest depressions that I can find, and then spread them out and compact them. These are the main depressions I've targeted around the garden, and all of them are at least a couple of inches in depth. So let me take you through one of these low areas in a little bit more detail. This is an area that I repaired in a video not that long ago, which is actually this area here, which is standing up quite nicely. Now it highlights the area next door. So here I've got maybe 2.5 inches, maybe 60, 70 mil of gap. It goes in this direction, it goes in this direction as well. So the first thing we need is a big blob of sand. So with a rake, I'm just going to very roughly smooth it out, leaving the majority of the sand in the middle where the big dip is. Then comes compaction. So just doing that, I can actually feel when I'm walking over it, it's gone down quite a lot here. So now I need to top it up a little bit and maybe do it again. Feel that there's a bit of a dip here. I need some more material in. That's the one. So just with the basic rake, I can tell by the way the sand is moving over the surface, it's a lot flatter. It's not flat, it's just a lot flatter. But the secret weapon now is my lawn leveling lute. More material. After attending to the main depressions, I started to spread the sand uniformly over the whole area of the lawn. I found using my rake was a quick way of generally spreading it out before changing over to the lute. In the general areas, most of the sand tends to just disappear into the short grass, and you have to just trust that the lute is spreading it evenly, as you can't really tell at this point. The whole process of moving the sand and spreading it around is, as you can imagine, quite tiring and takes quite a bit of time, obviously depending on the size of your garden. I found that the two bulk bags that I purchased was just about enough for my area, but with no material left over. So I think we're going to call that the end of day one. I've just distributed two full bulk bags of sand, which I think is pretty good going for someone half my age. I must say this lawn leveling lute really helped to spread it evenly and to fill up all the valleys and keep away from the high points. The only thing is, it does feel an awful lot heavier than it did earlier today. I don't know why that is. So we've got the sand down. The lawn is a lot flatter than it was before, and I need to overseed. But there's an important step here that most people miss, and I've not seen it on any other YouTube video, and that is a glass of wine. So I've just had a look at what I did yesterday, and it all looks really quite nice. So now I do need to do some seeding. Before I put the seed down, what I'm going to do is just use the rake to make some furrows so the seed has got somewhere to sit in. And then I'll show you afterwards how I close those up. But first of all, I need to finish my coffee. I very lightly rake the surface, so I don't move the sand around the lawn, other than creating the furrows, which I'll be able to close back up and still keep a flat surface. This is the seed I'm using today. It's from the Grass People. They're very easy to find online, but I'll put a link in the description below. And the reason I went for this one was because I wanted 100% perennial ryegrass. And this gives it to me. It's got what they call their amenity mix. It's like a sports mix. And it's got various different types of ryegrass, but nothing else. So I'm trialing 100% ryegrass this year after watching Daniel Hibbert, who's got an excellent YouTube lawn care channel. I'll put a link to his channel in the description below. And I've calculated that at 35 grams per square meter, which is pretty standard overseeding rate, I'm gonna need half of this bag, that's 10 kilograms, on my main lawn. But before I spread that, by hand, I'm going to give additional seed to all those really deep areas where I don't expect the grass to ever come through that sand. And then I'm going to spread the rest of it over the whole thing with my spreader. Whenever I sow seed, it always seems to be a windy day. But anyway, standing upwind and giving it multiple light passes spreads the seed fairly evenly. While I'm at it, I also hand sow along the edge of the border, so I don't need to get so close to this with the spreader, or else I'll end up seeding the flower bed, which I really don't want to do. This hopper takes around 5 kilograms of seed, so I fill it up and then on a low setting take multiple passes around the lawn in different directions to try to get an even coverage. This takes a bit longer, but it does give you a better result. So that's the seeding done, and if you've got a spreader, it makes the seeding an awful lot easier and quicker, and it distributes the seeds so much more uniformly. It's a really good investment to make, even if you're just doing this once a year, and obviously you can use it for fertilizer as well. So we all know for seeds to germinate, we need three things. We need temperature, we need moisture, and we need contact with the soil. Temperature should be okay. We're at the end of May, beginning of June. Moisture I can control with my watering over the next couple of weeks. A contact with the soil is important. So at this point, if you've got a roller, it's a really good idea to roll the lawn. So those seeds sitting in the furrows that I made with the rake earlier are now closed up and you've got that good seed to soil contact. Now I haven't got a roller, but I've got the next best thing, and that is my Allet Kensington. Without using the cutting function, I'm just relying on the back roller and the vibration of the machine to flatten back down the furrows. This actually works really well, and better than a roller, as it's powered, so at least I don't have to drag it around. However, I do get some strange looks from the neighbours who can't believe I'm cutting the grass again. That's after they've seen me cut the grass the first time, and scarify it, which to them looks like cutting grass, and me cutting the grass the second time. The last thing I have to do is to water the seed, which I do by hand fairly lightly so I don't disturb the seed and end up washing it away.
So after all of the lugging of material about and doing everything I've just done, this is definitely the most relaxing part. And I'm just giving it a quick cover of water. That means that I can make sure that the seeds don't go anywhere while I'm doing this before tomorrow, starting with my pop-up sprinklers that will definitely come in useful over the next couple of weeks to be able to water this regularly. So I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, please check out the other ones on the channel and please subscribe. And please go and have a look at our Patreon page where the membership is growing and there's extra content over there. So I've got probably about another half an hour of doing this. But at least that doesn't mean I'm lugging material about, so that's good, isn't it? See you next time.